Thank you. Morning. I'm wearing my green for St. Paddy's Day. I'm 2 days late. But I also put on the hashtag in case you forgot about it. It's right here for whenever you need it. But I have been traveling a lot lately, and I'm going to log in here. I met this guy recently. We're talking on the plane, and we're talking about family, friends, you name it. But then over time, what happened is I finally asked him, what do you do for a living? He goes, well, I'm a musician. So we didn't realize I was going to bombard him for 10 minutes straight about, if you use mobile, social, all these digital capabilities, you could get your name out there and make a lot of money. So all of a sudden, this lady comes up, and she asked me for my autograph. And I'm so excited. I go, I can't wait to tell my wife and my two little girls that someone recognized me on the plane. Now, keep in mind, my little girls are both under 3, so they wouldn't know what I was talking about. But I was super excited about it. And this lady leans across me to get 5-time Grammy Award-winning James Taylor's autograph. We got a little James Taylor for you here this morning in a second. We'll play a little bit in a moment here. But I'm sitting there super red because I can't believe that there's James. That I've got another 2 hours on this flight with James Taylor, who I just told maybe you could have some success if you use social media. But I'm going to show you a quick video here that I also showed James when I was on the flight. We opened with the opening video, but since we're near another holiday, Valentine's Day, I thought this video would be appropriate just to showcase how much our lives have changed, because sometimes we forget how much our lives have changed in the last couple years. We had some fun with that. Actually, a lot of my single buddies asked my wife, hey, that Rachel Qualman, is she single? But she's fictitious. But what is Socialnomics? Socialnomics at a 10-second level is simply word of mouth on digital steroids, or word of mouth is now world of mouth. As we've seen statistically, is that 90% of us trust what our peers recommend, but only 14% of us trust what advertising says. So it's important in this world where there's so much transparency that it's really about that peer-to-peer, that word of mouth on digital steroids. So that sounds fun, that sounds good, but really, what's the reality of that situation today? Some markets move super fast in the digital world, and those are usually leisure, it's also music, it's travel, it's auto. But these two screenshots are coming from Yelp and also from TripAdvisor. And they're using a tool called Facebook Connect, which a lot of us in this room know what Facebook Connect is. But if you ever had to explain it to your grandparents, it's essentially you just need to remember your Facebook login no matter what website you're on. So now we can remove all those yellow post-it notes around our iPad or around our computer screen for all of our passwords, which is nice. But the real power, the real socialnomic power, is when you look at it in this situation. So how many of you guys use TripAdvisor? Great, majority of the room. So TripAdvisor's been around for a while. Very helpful tool. If I'm traveling to Cabo San Lucas, I want to get some ratings and reviews, comes back. Here's 104 ratings and reviews for Cabo San Lucas for that particular hotel. Very helpful. Now when you layer on Socialnomics or Facebook Connect to that, it becomes even more helpful. Because as you can see, this is from my account, is that when I go to TripAdvisor, since I'm logged into Facebook, it tells me 40 of my friends have stayed in Cabo San Lucas. And if I were to click on that and drill down on that, it would tell me which hotels and where they stayed and also what their ratings were. So all of a sudden, if I have three friends, two which I trust wholeheartedly on their travel decisions, one who has terrible taste that I don't trust, is that's infinitely helpful for me. If those two give it 5-star rating, all of a sudden, that saves me a lot of time and a lot of stress I'm going to book at that hotel. Now, if you want to take it to the next level in terms of the stalker level, you can see in the upper right, it shows which ones of my friends are nearby in Cabo San Lucas when I'm actually physically there. So that is what Socialnomics is all about. In time, all products and services will be rated. And also in time, you, people, will be rated. So what does that look like? How's a person rated? We're already starting to see the beginning of that rating system. Whether you look at a tool like LinkedIn, where you can get recommendations from your peers, from your bosses, from people that work for you, but also with their launch of the endorsement tab, which is very similar to the Facebook like button. It's very easy within seconds to just endorse someone. Maybe they're a great accountant. Maybe they're good at marketing. You can just quickly endorse them on LinkedIn. So that's part of your rating. The other tool out there is like Cred and Clout. If you look at Clout, that's a tool that'll give you a ranking from 0 to 100 or a score from 0 to 100, with 100 being the best. So that's trying to pinpoint your influence in different market segments. Are you a 70 in the music industry? Are you an 80 in the movie industry? The highest ranking score is Barack Obama at 99. It used to be Justin Bieber, but they figured having the Biebs number one didn't look good, so they adjusted their algorithm a couple months ago, and I think now he's got a score of a 91. So companies can use clout in various ways. One quick example is that recently at Fashion Week in New York, you had to have a clout score of 70 or higher in the fashion industry to get in certain parties at night. So it was the only time I ever got an exclusive party. It was nice. So what does it look like for you sometimes? You're sitting there going, well, this is great, we're bought in, but where does it reside within the company? Sometimes we have to figure out exactly where does this sit within the company. Well, it sits, should sit with your CEO and your executive. It should sit top down, and then everyone should be involved within the company. And that makes sense, because social media is less about technology and more about relationships. It's living, it's breathing, it's your customer. Now, this screenshot's from a regional airline in the US called JetBlue, and they do a very good job when it comes to social media. Now, this is from 31 Minutes on their Twitter account, and what it's showcasing is exactly that, that it touches every facet of the business, which makes sense because it's your customer. So if we look at it, it's public relations, customer service, sales, crisis management, recruiting, product development. So for the sake of time, I'm not going to read through all of these, but most of us are interested in sales. So if we look at this middle one from Einstein, it says trying to see if JetBlue still has the unlimited flying pass for the month. So within 5 minutes, JetBlue responds and says, we still have that pass for 2 more days. Here's the hyperlink for you to get it. So there's your sale. But as you can see, I'm showing this chart in 31 minutes. It does touch every piece of your business. All right, so what does it look like internally, structurally? And this is from Altimeter Group's Jeremiah Aoyang. Great guy. If you want to follow him on Twitter, he's got some great stuff. If we look at this, there's really just 5 models they've been able to determine on how it's functioning inside of your company. We'll start on the very left, which they call the distributed model. I call it the Wild West model. Just everyone's kind of, there's no rhyme or reason. People are just tweeting on behalf of the company, in the company. There's no structure or coordination. Systematically, most companies fall within 2 and 3 here, where you've got either a centralized unit that's kind of approving everything, which doesn't scale, or hopefully you've gone to this third model, which is more of a hub and spoke, to where you've got the experts that sit in the middle, but the business units can kind of do what they want on Twitter, Pinterest, Instagram, Facebook. But there's a central coordinated model to make sure that there's some coordination. Now, what you want to try to strive to get to is that fifth model, which looks like a golf ball. That's where everyone in the company is invested in social media. So it could be that person in the IT department can respond to that particular tweet. So everyone's kind of trained and invested. Less than 2% of companies have gotten to that golf ball model. That's in organizations. That's like the Red Cross, Zappos, and Dell. Now, the one model that's not on here that you really want to get to is where all those little dots are outside of that golf ball, because then that means your customer is owning your brand and taking it in the place that you want it to go. So if you want your customers to own your brand, which they will, is that if content is king, think about, this isn't checkers, this is actually a game of chess when we talk about the digital marketplace. And if you've heard that content is king, then really the culture of your company, your organization, your small business is checkmate. And so what does that look like? Really what it looks like is if you want your customer to own your brand, or they're going to own it, so you want to get ahead of it and want them to own it, you should ask 3 questions internally. Now, when I visit Fortune 500 companies and ask these questions over a 24-hour period, I usually interview about 50 to 100 people. 90% of the time, I get different answers. That's a problem. It's a problem because if you're not on the same page internally, then externally, how do you expect your customer to take the brand where you want it to go? These questions are very simple. It's what's our reason for being? Why do we exist as a company? Second is, how do we differ from the competition? And the third one is, if we shut our doors tomorrow, what's the loss to society? Because a lot of Gen Y and Gen Z, soon to be Gen Z workers, want to know why, what am I doing? What am I contributing by working at this brand, at this company? So it's important to answer that question as well. So we talk about culture is checkmate. Another thing to keep in mind is that there's 2 things that drive the success of any business, no matter what you sell. The first one is getting the right people on the team. And so we could talk about 3 hours about how LinkedIn's replaced the paper resume, but the first one is getting the right people on the team. The second one, which we're going to focus more on today, is really the second most important piece is word of mouth, which we just mentioned. Word of mouth is now word of mouth, or word of mouth is on digital steroids. That will drive the success of any business. Those are the 2 most important success factors, no matter what you sell. So let's look at what does drive success when we look at it within social media. I'm not going to spend too much time on this slide, but it's really about listen, interact, react, and then sell. Now, most of us are in the business, we want to sell right away. That's in our DNA. That's in our DNA as a company. But the reason that doesn't work in a digital world is because it doesn't work in an offline world. So think about the morning breakfast session here. If you saw 3 people having an enjoyable conversation over coffee, you wouldn't walk up to them, hopefully you wouldn't do this, you wouldn't walk up to them and say, excuse me, can I interrupt you and tell you why I'm great for the next 5 minutes? Wouldn't go over so well. And it doesn't go over well in the digital world, but we forget these constructs when we get into the digital world. So listen, what's being said about me, my product, my company? Interact, join the conversation. The third piece is to react. This is where most companies fail. Is if 80% say they don't like something about what you're doing, are you changing it today? Are you changing that today? What's your culture design? How flexible is it to change it today? Just as important, but often overlooked, is if 90% love something you're doing, are you changing that today? Sure, if someone posts something negative about you online, you might have that Saturday morning meeting at 8 a.m., all hands on to figure out how do we resolve this negative issue that's arisen online. But how many of you are having that same conversation if 90% of your best customers, your best clients are saying, I love this, about your company, your product? Are you having that same meeting to figure out how do we do more of this? The flip side, your customer does the exact same thing. Now, how many of you guys bought something in the last 30 days? Exactly, we're all customers. Sometimes in our day-to-day we forget that, but we're all customers. We all do the same thing. We listen, what can I expect from this product, this service? I interact with it, I buy it, I use it, then I react. Based on my expectation, was this a good or was this a bad experience? Then the fourth piece is what's new. Really what I just talked about has kind of been happening for the last couple hundred years. The fourth piece is now new because now the customer, your client, can sell for or against you using all of these digital tools out there. So now we're going to take a quick look at some examples. Oh, before I get into this, first, some of you guys might be saying, oh my gosh, that slide you just showed me is from 2009. I've known that since 2009. The reason I show that is basically only 15% of the best companies are currently doing what I call a listening report, to where you're supplying to your executives a 1 to 2 page report that says, here's what's being said positive and negative about our products, our service, about our organization. And here's the same exact report for our competition. Only 15% supply these listening reports. So though some of you guys might be saying, and I would be too, oh my gosh, that slide's from 2009, I stress that point because no one's producing these listening reports that are so important to the executives. And those listening reports can bubble up from all the analytics tools you have, but those two reports, those 1 to 2 pages, have to be handwritten. It has to take a human to look at that and provide that summarized detail to your executives. Now, a lot of you guys, if not all of you guys, have seen this video. I'm going to play it just for those that haven't, and I'm going to explain the flip side of, like, a lot of people don't understand the opportunity that happened around this outside of the bad customer service issue from United Airlines. So for those that haven't seen it, this Canadian flew into the U.S. on United Airlines. He's a musician. He's not James Taylor, but he flew in, and what happened is that his guitar got damaged. And all he wanted, just like all of us in this room wanted, he wanted to be listened to, he wanted to be heard, and he wanted United to pay for the damage, which they damaged his guitar. But United, after a year, said, you know, Dave Carroll, can you please, from Nova Scotia, please go away? We're not going to pay for your guitar. But then Dave said, well, this is a new age. I can sell for or against you, United, using all of these digital tools at my disposal. And since I am a musician, I'm going to go on YouTube and post my story. And this is Dave's story.
I flew United Airlines on my way to Nebraska. The plane departed Halifax, connecting in Chicago's O'Hare. While on the ground, a passenger said from the seat behind me, my God, they're throwing guitars out there. The band and I exchanged a look, best described as terror, at the action on the tarmac, and knowing whose projectiles these would be. So before I left Chicago, I alerted three employees who showed complete indifference towards me. Someone else, you're gone by car. 'Cause United breaks guitars. When we landed in Nebraska, I confirmed what I'd suspected. Mike Taylor'd been the victim of a vicious act of malice at O'Hare. So began a year-long saga of pass the buck, don't ask me, and I'm sorry, sir, your claim can go nowhere.
All right, we'll stop it right there. For those who want to watch the whole thing, it's on YouTube. It's got 15 million views. Now, how many of you guys had not seen that? Okay, a decent amount. So obviously, there's a customer service issue, which I don't want to talk about that. That's pretty straightforward on the United Airlines side of the house. But what I want to talk about is the opportunity that exists for all of us if we're properly listening, that first step that we talked about. So does anyone know what kind of guitar that he mentioned? Taylor guitar. So Bob Taylor in California, Taylor Guitars, gets online and he says, "Hey Dave, sorry this happened to you. I'm inviting you and your wife to come tour our facility and I'll give you two brand new Taylor guitars." He also shot another video that same day, just in the warehouse, real quick, that said, "Hey, this is Bob Taylor. Sorry this happened to Dave Carroll. Just avoid this happening to you because this happens a lot. People damage their guitars when they're traveling. Here's a couple tips so it doesn't happen to you and you don't damage your Taylor guitar." There's a B2B company that reached out to Dave Carroll that sells these guitar cases, and now they have a Dave Carroll guitar case. And then Dave's done quite well for himself, which is a great story because he's a great guy. And he's sold a lot of music on iTunes for this song you just saw at 99 cents. He also has a book called United Breaks Guitars as well. So three different opportunities just from that one incident that occurred. All right, the other change that we're seeing in this marketplace, this really hits home. This is more on the personal level. It's also on the brand level, but it really hits home for all of us in this room, is that we're all really creating a digital legacy or a digital stamp, if you will. And it's comprised of two components. It's comprised of your digital footprint, and it's comprised of your digital shadow. Now, your digital footprint, you have somewhat of control over. That's anything that you upload about yourself. So anything you post online about yourself, that's your digital footprint. But more important is your digital shadow. Whether it's for you personally or whether it's for your brand, that's what others are posting about you online. So together, they're your digital stamp. They're your ultimate digital legacy, starting here and now today, for the next minute, next 2 minutes, tomorrow, but also 50 years, 100 years, 200 years from now, what's going to be your ultimate digital stamp, your ultimate digital legacy, whether as a person or whether as a company?
That's tomorrow, and that is it for us today.
Well, let me set this up a little bit. So this is a famous newscaster in the United States. And does anyone remember what rickrolling was a couple years ago? All right, so they decided to rickroll this newscaster. Rickrolling, for those that don't remember, was you'd get maybe an email that said, "Hey, check out the latest sales figures." And you'd go and click on that hyperlink, and you're thinking, "This is going to take me to an Excel spreadsheet." Instead, it takes you to a cheesy 1980s video by Rick Astley, which we'll play here. You'll recognize the song once you see it. And so they decide to rickroll this newscaster, Bill O'Reilly, and we'll see what happens.
That's tomorrow, and that is it for us today. Okay, I don't know. Whatever it is, it's not right on the teleprompter. I don't know what that is. I've never seen that. Okay, but yeah, I can't read it. There's no words on it. There's no words there to play us out. What does that mean, to play us out?
Sting is going to do, it's a video, Sting video.
What is,
for credits.
I don't know what that means, to play us out. What does that mean? To end the show?
Yeah, yeah.
All right, go.
In 5, 4, 3.
That's tomorrow, and that is up. That's tomorrow, and that is it for us today, and we will leave you with a... I can't do it. We'll do it live. We'll do it live! Do it live! I'll write it, and we'll do it live! Fucking thing sucks! That's tomorrow, and that is it for us today. I'm Bill O'Reilly. Thanks again for watching. We'll leave you with Sting and a cut off his new album. Take it away.
All right, why do I show you that video? I show you that video because it's, I think it's hilarious, but no. Even if I was talking about furniture, I might show that video. But one, I apologize for the swearing in the video, but that's how it is on YouTube. Also, is the reason I show that is that's part of his digital legacy. And what happened offline, it's part of his digital shadow. That happened offline. Obviously, some producer didn't like him, uploaded that to YouTube. So let's take a look at that from the business standpoint. And this is a quick commercial. I'm going to talk through it a little bit. But as we watch this commercial, what Nokia is trying to showcase, this is from this year, is that, hey, their new phone's great. When you film with it, when they turn on their operating system, that it doesn't shake. So you can film your girlfriend on her bike if you ever wanted to do that. I don't know why you'd want to do that. But you'd film her with your phone, and it doesn't shake. But see if you can notice anything wrong with this video. There we go. They filmed this with a mounted high-definition camera from a van. It wasn't from the phone that they were saying they were filming it from. So this happened this year. You'd think you'd know not to do this in this day and age, but they need someone internally, a leader like yourself, to stand up and say, this is a really bad idea. There's a lot of people out there that have time to put up videos about cats. There's a lot of people that have time to slow down this video if you happen to go by a mirror and have the bad luck of the film crew going by a mirror while they're filming. So they had to come out and apologize. They had to pull this ad. All right, let's look at Chrysler. So this young man, how many of you guys use a tool called Hootsuite? Anybody in here? A lot of you guys, I use it myself. It helps you manage your Twitter, your Google Plus, for anybody that uses that, your Facebook feed. And so this young man from Chrysler Cars, actually the agency for Chrysler, hit the wrong button. He thought he was posting this to his personal Twitter account. Instead, he hit the wrong button. He posted it to Chrysler's account. And for those in the back, I find it ironic that Detroit is known as the hashtag Motor City, and yet no one here knows how to blanking drive. Obviously, he used the full word here. He didn't have the stars that I put across this. So he's fired, agency fired the same day. Now, I use that mainly to set up this one. Young lady at the Red Cross, remember going back to those models I showed you, that the Red Cross is one of the companies that has trained their entire organization on social media. Young lady does the exact same thing. She hits the wrong button on Hootsuite, posts on behalf of the entire Red Cross this tweet. Ryan found two more 4-bottle packs of Dogfish Head's Midas Touch beer. When we drink, we do it right. Hashtag getting slizzard. Now, in this instance, since they've trained their entire staff on social media, within 4 minutes, a young man from the IT department posts, we've deleted the rogue tweet, but rest assured the Red Cross is sober, and we have confiscated the keys. So in this instance, nobody is fired. Their donations go dramatically up for the week. The beer company mentioned gets involved and says, instead of donating a pint of blood this week, why don't you donate, instead of donating a pint of beer, why don't you donate a pint of blood or donate some money to the Red Cross? Huffington Post, New York Times, Wall Street Journal picks this up because it's a fun story, and away we go. Donations go through the roof. And so essentially, it's not a question of if we're going to make a mistake. It's a question of when and how we handle it in the social media world. So that gets, again, back to that culture that we started this presentation with. And to use a play on word, it's really all about being flossome. So Anne Hadley informed me of this word. I go, that word's great. So it's really just how to show how awesome you are, either as an individual or as an organization or a business, when you do make a mistake. How do you take advantage of that mistake? To be cliche, how do you make digital lemonade out of digital lemons? So let's look at Wheat Thins. So how many people buy crackers online here? Yeah, someone ruined that for me the other day. They were buying crackers through Amazon Prime. I'm like, oh man, that's crazy, but that's good. But most of us have to go to the store to physically buy crackers. And so it would have been easy for Wheat Thins or whatever you're trying to sell when you look at it, whether it's B2B or whether you're selling motor oil, and you say, well, that's for the Nikes of the world, this fun social media stuff or this mobile stuff. It's not for us. We sell crackers. But instead, what Wheat Thins decides to do is they go, let's go see if anyone's talking about crackers online. And I, surprisingly enough, a lot of people talk about crackers. And a lot of people talk about Wheat Thins. So one young lady posts, ah, I'm out of Wheat Thins. My life is officially over. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, man, I wish I had that girl's life. It sounds pretty easy. But let's see what Wheat Thins decides to do about this dilemma.
This one's hilarious. Ah, I'm out of Wheat Thins. My life is officially over. Kind of dramatic. Tabitha.
Yes.
Okay, do you recall tweeting, ah, I'm out of Wheat Thins. My life is officially over?
Yeah.
We got a hold of that. We just want you to be sure that you're aware that we have plenty of Wheat Thins. And that's for you. That's just a gift.
That is a lot of Wheat Thins. Oh my gosh.
Everybody in the van, let's go. In the truck. Take care, all right? Come on, boys. Who's next?
All right, they do a good job with that. I think IKEA does a good job with this functionality that they have, is that you can go onto Facebook and use this tool that they have to where you can go in and I want my room designed by IKEA. And what it'll do is it'll look at information that you have online, a little bit scary, but it looks for information and it knows what city that you're located in. So it's gonna design your apartment differently if you live in Toronto versus if you live in Vancouver. It's also gonna pull in, like these photos on the wall, it's gonna pull in images of you from the web, from your Facebook account, and put those on the picture frames in the room. So it's literally trying to design that room for you with IKEA furniture. So that's some of the stuff that we can do out there. Is anyone in the room from B2B? Just a couple. Okay, so the B2B side, the quick, short version of it, obviously you can use this social media as well on B2B. It's very analogous to me 10 years ago, or even 15 maybe it's now, is that looking at Google, a lot of people thought there was gonna be a different Google for B2B companies, and what happened? No, there's just one Google. Everyone kind of uses it the same way. So the same thing, use 90% of the same tips and tactics for B2C you can use for B2B. One thing that IBM has done is that they are looking out for a word called request for proposal, or RFP. So every time someone's asking about an RFP, they engage those people because they know that company's looking for a solution and looking to pay for a solution. So they've increased their sales 400% just by doing that one simple trick. And this is IBM, so 400%, that's in millions and millions and millions of dollars in revenue increase. All right, let's look at a small business example. Are there any small businesses in the room? Okay, a decent amount, but also, again, all these examples, you need to put your own filter on because you can use something from them to do it for your industry. So Gary Vaynerchuk, he's out of New Jersey. He sells wine out of one store in New Jersey called Wine Library. And he decides to start teaching people online about wine through video. So I'm going to show you episode 1, and then we'll show you episode 505, and we'll see if there's any differences.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the first episode of Wine Library TV. I am Gary Vaynerchuk, Director of Operations here at Wine Library at winelibrary.com, and I am very proud to launch what we think is the first video wine blog. We've been talking about doing a blog here at Wine Library for a long time.
Okay, that's Gary. Kind of what you'd expect from a wine video. And he gets input from his fan base, and he listens, interacts, and reacts. And they say, Gary, this is super boring. I can get this anywhere online. I can get this from a book. There's tons of wine connoisseurs that can teach me in this fashion. That's not what I want. I want to learn in a fun way, Gary. Where's the real Gary? Where's my New Jersey Gary? So Gary listens, interacts, but most importantly, he reacts. Because he understands you're not going to get it right the first time. It's all about failing fast, failing forward, and failing better. So let's see if we can notice any change when I show you episode 505.
Wine Library TV. I am your host, Gary Vaynerchuk. Say it with me, Vaniacs. And this, my friends, is the Thunder Show, aka the internet's most passionate wine program. I'm a 24/7 Vedra. 20 US dollars. Pretty nose, like an éclair, like, you know, let's give it a whirl. Nice fruit, dark chocolate, so let's go with like a 70% cocoa count coming through on this. Some lavender on the back end, which I like.
All right, that's Gary. He's not for everybody, but he is for his audience base. And what do we see is he changes what he was doing because nobody was watching it. And he goes in 2 years' time from selling $4 million in wine to selling $50 million in wine. And what he'll tell you is that the videos didn't sell any wine. What sold was that allowed for that discussion, that interaction online in the digital world on mobile, to where if someone tweeted about this video, he could then engage that person and say, glad you liked the video. If you try any of my wine, let me know. If you get any wine out of our store, let me know. 4 million, 50 million, there's your ROI. And Gary's funny because they'll ask him, what's the ROI? And he goes, to me, the ROI of social media is like asking, what's the ROI of your mother? You know there is one, but can you calculate it? I'm going to send this sheet out to you. These are just all free tools that you can use. There's a website here as well that we've got over 100 tools. Some are free, some are paid, where you can track your digital reputation. One quick tool, since we're at a networking event, for those that do have the iPhone, I think they're going to launch the Android app here soon. Do any of you guys use a tool called Card Munch? Okay, just a couple of you. It's a great tool, especially for an event like this. So if you get someone's card, you can just take a picture of it with your phone. It automatically uploads to your contacts. But more importantly, it actually reaches out to LinkedIn. And if that person has a LinkedIn account, it'll pull that person's picture in and also all their LinkedIn information. And it gives you a quick button that says connect with this person on LinkedIn. Again, that's called Card Munch. It was a small company that was purchased by LinkedIn recently. I was just out in Mountain View and actually met this guy. His business card literally said Chief Card Muncher. So he's pretty happy. Sell your company for a couple million. All right, let's take a look at some trends. I'm just going to spend just a second on each one of these. We could go into a couple hours on each one of these. But these are the trends, in my mind, that get me the most excited and what's out there on the horizon 1, 2 years. Who knows? Maybe it happens tomorrow. Sometimes this stuff moves super fast. So we just mentioned LinkedIn. LinkedIn, if you have a 100% complete profile, then you have a 40 times more job opportunities and also 40 times more business opportunities if you already have a job. And LinkedIn will tell you if you had 100% completion or not. Everyone loves talking about Twitter. They love talking about Facebook. But really, the sexiest play to me is LinkedIn. They're a little monopoly out there. And they're the one few tool that's also not blocked in China. Also, for all you digital marketers in the room, expect soon that your company most likely will hand you the keys to LinkedIn. Across the board at the top companies, they're pulling it out of the HR department and giving it to the digital savants, the digital marketers, the digital media guys within the organization. So soon that might land on your plate as well. A lot of smart companies are designing mobile first and then going to design the rest of their items. And this makes sense because mobile forces you into the 80-20 rule. It's a great thing, because historically a website, you could post everything because it's infinite inventory. Mobile forces you to really make a hard decision as a business to give the customer exactly what they want, that 80-20. By giving them everything, you give them nothing. This forces them, companies, to give the customer exactly what they want, that 80-20 rule. Mobile commerce, mobile wallets. Mobile wallets important because companies like Walmart and Target, they don't want to pay that 3% transaction fee to the credit card company. And since most of us are getting used to using our phone to purchase stuff, they want to eliminate the credit card. Also, they want to own the data of the customer. That's the other reason they want to do that, because right now the credit card company owns that transaction data. But Walmart, the Starbucks, they've done a deal with Square. But Target, they want to own that experience. They want to eliminate the 3%, and they want to own the data. So that's a big trend we look out there. Also, talking about leading with mobile first, There's companies like Starbucks that they've changed and morphed. When Howard Schultz came back in 2008, he realized he needed to become a digital leader. He was a traditional leader, and he's morphed into a digital leader. And now Starbucks is a company that's a digital company that just happens to sell coffee. So those are the transformations that we're seeing out there. Speaking of mobile, for democracies such as Canada, if you look at it, or US, mobile voting. So that you can just sign up and say, I only care about these issues. Send me a note when a vote comes up for it, and I can just hit the button to vote. That's like 10, 15 years out, but it's an important thing that's going to be coming here, hopefully sooner than 10 years. You've heard the term big data. If you're explaining this to someone on the street, it's just taking unstructured data. So whether that's a transaction through a credit card at the point of sale, or whether it's all these tweets, all these posts on Facebook, all this data that's out there that's unstructured, and making it structured. In other words, making sense of it, making it actionable. So if we look at that from an example standpoint, from a city, what that would look like is that the city of Toronto could look at it and say, okay, most crime occurs between 7 and 10 p.m. in this specific location. So at 6 p.m., we're going to put more police in that location, so we're going to prevent crime ahead of time. Also, big data for those of you guys that are big into basketball, if you look at like March Madness, a quick, simple form of big data in March Madness is ahead of time trying to figure out which 68 teams are going to be selected for the NCAA tournament. So big data is applicable across the board. Artificial intelligence. Steve Wozniak, one of the founders of Apple, when he was on stage recently, they asked him, what do you think the biggest trend is? And he goes, I think we're underestimating just how important artificial intelligence is going to be from a standpoint of, for a lot of us, our best friend's going to be our phone. That's how advanced something like Siri is going to become. Now, from a marketing standpoint or a business standpoint, that becomes important because, as we talked about with Socialnomics, word of mouth on digital steroids, is now you're going to ask your artificial intelligence, hey, I need a pair of jeans. What do you recommend? Where should we buy them? And it automatically feeds in there based on all that data that's out there from your networks, from your peers, from your friends. So in the future, it might be us as marketers trying to influence that artificial intelligence. Amazon same day delivery, coming soon to a city near you. So Amazon's buying all these warehouses. Essentially what happened in the United States is that the short story is that they wanted to start taxing Amazon. State by state needed money, let's tax Amazon, they're not taxed. So Amazon being smart said, well, if you're gonna tax us, then we're gonna use the roads, we're gonna use the fire department, we're gonna use the police. So we're gonna buy these warehouses, which makes sense because then that politically provides pressure to now all these local businesses say, do not tax Amazon. If they put a warehouse in our city, we're gonna go out of business if they offer same day delivery on all their goods and services. So anyways, those are major ripples that are happening across the board when you think about that same day delivery from Amazon. Momentum marketing and content creation, that's what a lot of us can take advantage of today. 20% of all Google searches that happen today are gonna be brand new terms. So how nimble is your culture to take advantage of that? So an example might be that the royal wedding, think about the royal wedding. That's kind of a new term that comes up out of nowhere, but it's huge. How do you own those terms within mobile and within Google across the board? By posting that content. Then all of a sudden, Pippa Middleton gets out of that car. And how do you quickly discern the data that that person's gonna be big? That's a brand new name, Pippa Middleton, that's not on the radar. How do you take advantage of that as a company? How do you post stuff about that for these 20% new terms that happen every day? How nimble are we as a company? In closing, I'm gonna show you this quick video just to showcase what could happen in the next 6 years. And after this video, we'll wrap things up and we'll go from there.
I heard you on the wireless back in '52, lying on started tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Thank you guys for having me here, but I want to say, as all of you guys are digital leaders in the space, are you failing fast? Are you failing forward? Are you failing better? Are you listening, interacting, reacting, then selling? And most importantly, are you adjusting your culture? Are you being that leader inside of your organization to adjust your culture to make sure you're nimble enough to take advantage of all those opportunities out there that we just went over in the last 40 minutes? But I wanted to thank you. The one thing this thing failed to mention this last video is I haven't been able to resolve how to sign a Kindle. So I will be signing books out here right after this, and I'll also be taking questions and answers for those people that don't even want a book but just want to ask a question. But I just want to thank everybody, and hopefully we'll have a good conversation out here in the hallway. Take care.
I told you we had a rock star on the video.